Mahidharia. His talk is a fast 3D model creation using FreeCAD. Anool works at Lumatronics designing custom safety test equipment. He's also a co-founder of Wylam and a co-founder of Makers Asylum, India's first open community makerspace. He also takes time to write blog posts for Hackaday. If you've seen his name, that's probably why. So welcome, Anool.
Thank you. Just a couple of warnings. I was up until 12 last night, and I got up at 3 to get here from Pittsburgh. So if I fall asleep, just give me a kick on my shin and wake me up. Kind of feeling a little fuzzy over here. But so Wylam is essentially a group of open source enthusiasts. We collaborate and build projects when we get time for fun. And we've been doing it since the last 10 years. And the first time I used KiCad was back in 2009 when I evaluated GEDA, Eagle, as well as KiCad, and I figured out that KiCad came closest to the way we designed boards before computers came along. When we used to do things manually using drafting tools and so on, we'd make a quick sketch and then build a bomb and then actually, you know, figure out which values to use and so on. So the KiCad process seemed pretty natural extension of how things were done in the old days, and I kind of like that. Also, excuse my voice, I have this little condition with my throat that makes it sound like I'm squeaking, but yeah, I'm fine. So FreeCAD is free, as in open source, just like KiCad. In recent years, we've had a great integration between FreeCAD and KiCad. Like KiCad, FreeCAD files are also plain text, and pretty much you can parse them through, you know, things like Python scripts and so on to do some fancy stuff. You can also write FreeCAD models using script writing, such as similar to OpenSCAD, for example. So if you're familiar with OpenSCAD, moving to FreeCAD is pretty easy. And of course, it's multi-platform, works on Linux, Mac, and Windows, all three, and like a few other CAD programs and so on. Open file format, so STEP, SIGES, STL, all of them, it supports a lot of them. It has a lot of different tools depending on what exactly. So the difference between a CAD, a Mech CAD, and a eCAD is a Mech CAD is supposed to do a lot of different things depending on what you want to build. If you want to build a ship or if you want to build a building, there are different tools you'd use. So the FreeCAD's approach is to have different workbenches depending on what work you want to do. And you have to get familiar with that part of the process before you start digging into it, because at first sight it might look intimidating to have a lot of tools available to you, a lot of workbenches, and you don't know which one does what and to work through it. So there's a bit of a steep learning curve to that, as with any CAD program, you really can't avoid it. You have to just dig into it and stay at it. So when you get started with KiCad, the first thing you need to obviously do is make sure you have set up the right preferences, because that matters a lot, especially if you set your wrong units or, you know, you do imperial metric conversions and stuff like that. So look up the preferences section of FreeCAD if you're using and setting it up for the first time, and make sure you set some of these parameters right from the get-go, especially things like units and so on. Two of the tools that you might like to, or the workbenches that you might like to import straight away is CAD Query and KiCad Step-Up Tools. CAD Query is basically scripting models in Python. So if you're familiar with just writing code, it's a good way to get started with creating CAD models, and kind of similar to how you would be using with, let's say, OpenSCAD. KiCad Step-Up Tools is a huge bridge between KiCad and FreeCAD, and it can do a lot of different things depending on what you want to achieve. One of the things it can do is import a footprint, and then import a step file, which is a model of your footprint, and then you can align it so that it matches without you having to do that translation in the KiCad side. The reason this is important is when you export it back from KiCad, you might lose the orientations if KiCad has applied certain special translations or position movements to make it fit right on the footprint. So step-up tools can do that. One of the other recent things it can do is you can import a KiCad PCB directly in FreeCAD, play around with component placements in case you want to, let's say, make a board fit an enclosure or you know have certain switches in certain positions, and then bring this whole thing back into KiCad, reflecting the new positions, and then maybe all you need to do is maybe redo a few tracks to reconnect what you've lost. But if you do this process before drawing tracks, it's even more easier and better. So there's a good back and forth flow between KiCad and FreeCAD now using the step-up tools workbench. So it's a great thing that you need to check out. There are different ways of building footprints in FreeCAD. The easiest way is using the part workbench for using what's known as primitives. So primitives are generally things like cubes or spheres or donuts or you know cones, and you click on the tool. You click on the tool and it just places that and plonks it at the center of your CAD space, and then you give it some dimensions as height, width, depth, and so on. But it's not really useful because when you start doing complicated shapes, you can't really start using primitives and building them because you have to do a lot of multiple operations like unions and cuts and so on to achieve what you want, and it's not really easy to using primitives to do that. So if you have simple parts like this inductor, then you'd probably just do it quickly in using the part workbench. Also, quite often manufacturers' data sheets don't have the right dimensions, so it's a big problem to figure out what exactly the size of the part is. A certain essential dimensions are missing. There are others that you have to infer from other dimensions and so on. So it's not always easy to create a CAD model from just the manufacturer's data sheet. And this one was pretty much guesstimated based on, there were just three dimensions given for this inductor, and I kind of just guesstimated around it and made something that fit. So if I don't have accurate dimensions to start with, I'd probably use something like a primitive approach to make something that looks what I want it to look like. It might not be accurate, but it works for what you want to do. And for each element that you build within the part workbench, you can then adjust its properties like its position in space, its angle in space, and its dimensions and so on. And that's how you build through this whole thing. So this particular inductor was built using a cube and a cylinder at the center, and four cubes to mark the solder pads. So that's the primitives that were used to do this. And if you drop in tomorrow, we'll probably try and build this during the workshop during the daytime. So if you have more complicated parts like this, then you have to start using another workbench that's known as the part design workbench. This allows you better control over how you build parts. You actually can draw a complex shape and then build that up into a 3D extrusion or make hollows into it and so on. And things get more better over here because you can set constraints and really precise control over how your drawing needs to be. So this, for example, is the profile of the inductor you saw over here. And the blue lines are construction lines to help you get positions, but are not part of the actual drawing itself. They're there just to guide you. And the green lines are the ones that are actually part of the part that gets extruded. And each part will have elements and constraints. So let's say you take a sphere in space, a circle in space. You have three constraints for it. It's XY position, if it's two-dimensional, and its radius. And because sketches are always two-dimensional, it's usually just three constraints that can set a circle. With a square or a rectangle, you'll have a little bit more constraints. It's length, its width, and the XY location of one of its corners, and the angle of the lines. And that sets the whole dimensions and the constraints for the. So setting constraints is what is done using the part design workbench. And then once the part is extruded, you want to cut out certain sections of it, which is what you do with a pocket constraint. So there are things like you can, when you draw a sketch, you can pull it up as an extrude, and that becomes a three-dimensional solid. And then you can draw another sketch on it and cut it out, so it becomes a pocket or a hollow from it. So certain objects you can build using revolve. Using the revolve function. So revolve is essentially you draw a sketch and then revolve it around whatever angle you want. Could be 360 usually, but you could even do any odd degree that you want. So this resistor was built using the sketch you see in blue lines over here, and then revolved over 360 degrees. And the sketch is actually parametric, so I can design or I can output resistors of different sizes by setting certain dimensions like the width and the diameter and so on. So that's the sketch that gets revolved around the x-axis. And these are the two the leads of it, and these are made using two sketches. Over here is a circle that is the diameter of the lead of the resistor, and then there is a path over here along which you extrude the circle. So that's a sweep function. And then I mirror the same thing on the other side and get the other part of the lead. So that's how you can design these kind of paths using circular functions. The best part is parametric design. So you can take one part and make sure the dimensions are such that you can actually look it up in a spreadsheet like this. And when you change dimensions, you can get a whole array of different parts ranging in size. So here's a 1206, and here's a 04 or 03, I think. Using the same drawing, but entering different numbers from this spreadsheet over here. For those who enjoy doing coding or programming, then CAD query is a great way to get started. And a large number of the current KiCad symbols have been made or generated using CAD query scripts, especially things like the SMD chip resistors, the whole range of capacitors, all of the through-hole resistors, most of the QFN chips and all of the other chips that you see, they have all been done using the CAD query scripts. I'm guessing we would be posting these slides online, so you should have these links available for getting the official libraries. FreeCAD has its own electrical library within which there is an electronic section that lets you download a lot of the electronic components. But then KiCad has its own library for 3D models that were essentially generated using FreeCAD. And this one is pretty interesting. Let me see if I can. So when you, let's say when you make a step model in CAD and you export it, when you use a step model in KiCad, for example, and export it into FreeCAD, you will lose certain information such as transparency or its shininess and so on. Certain of the components don't get translated. It just gets a flat color. And if you want to have that result, you will also have to associate an equivalent VRML or WRL file, which is an exact replica of the step file, and that will be able to translate all of the other color information that gets missed out in the step file. So KiCad has a document that gives you instructions on the standard coloring scheme to be used, what are the values to be used for the shininess and the part color and so on, things like your ceramic capacitors or your pin headers, plastics, inductors, and so on. So this is a great document that helps you get standardized, you know, coloring schemes which appear consistent across your designs. And it's a pretty detailed, there are two different documents. Both of them are pretty detailed and give you a lot of information on how you can get the right color in your designs for all of your parts. And then finally, Maurice has done this great job with KiCAD step-up tools. It initially started with a way to get a 3D model aligned to the footprint of your part. And that's all it did initially. But the recent versions are doing a huge amount of additional work. The latest I saw was you make a PCB in KiCAD. You then go to FreeCAD and open a KiCAD PCB natively. It imports all of it. It can also import tracks and the silk layer as well, if you need to for whatever reason. You can then play around with the placement of the parts so that you can align things with mounting holes or openings or switches or sockets and so on. You can even play around with moving around the edges of the board or the outline of the board in case that needs any correction. And once that gets saved, you can return back to KiCAD and all of those changes get reflected over here. And that gives you the full, interchangeability or, integration between the mechanical and the electrical design of your circuit. So it's pretty much well tightly integrated now. And I'm hoping we'll see more of FreeCAD-related, work in association with KiCAD as you go in the future. I think they both tie in very beautifully well together, these two programs. So here's what Maurice's step-up workbench looks like. You can import a footprint, you can import a step file, and then you can align them using these tools to rotate and place and so on. And then when you export it, it exports it both as a step file as well as a WRL file. So you don't have to use any of that old crazy Wings 3D software if any of you have used it earlier. A couple of years ago, the only way of getting 3D parts into a KiCAD was using Wings 3D. Was difficult to work with. Was the only WRL format that worked with KiCAD. You couldn't make a WRL file in different software and it wouldn't work with KiCAD. You had to run it through Wings 3D, and that's the only way you would get the 3D part to show up in KiCAD's viewer. The current KiCAD 3D viewer is actually running off the FreeCAD engine itself. So if you notice, there's a very great similarity between how things look in FreeCAD versus how they look in KiCAD as well. So that integration is getting better. But there's a lot of huge, that it's a crowded tool bench, and it has a lot of, really nice tools built in there. Things like if you want to check for collisions between parts, you want to check for clearances, and so on and so forth. So a pretty detailed work that lets you get your job done. And here's like you would import a footprint, you would import a step file. It's not aligned, so you'd use one of these tools to rotate it, place it where it needs to be. And then once you export it, it spits out the step file, and it also does the WRL file with the conversion for scaling, because every WRL file needs the metric to imperial conversion, 25.4 scaling factor or whatever. So it does all of that pretty well. And there's a great YouTube video. Brian Benchoff recently wrote about this a week or two back on Hackaday about this tool being shown with what its capabilities are. So easiest way to, I think, search this is using the Hackaday website, and it should probably come up the Step Up Tools Workbench video. So this is pretty amazing. He walks you through the whole process of how you take a KiCAD PCB, bring it into FreeCAD, move parts around, and then bring it back into KiCAD, and it shows up as it's supposed to. So I guess that's a wrap. This is something I did recently. You can see it out there. I set up a photo booth. This one's designed in FreeCAD, and I just put it here to show the capability of what FreeCAD can do. It's a lot of different parts put together. There's a Raspberry Pi, a touchscreen. It's got a power supply. that's integrated with a socket and a power switch, and the red part is the camera housing that pops in and out. So it's got a sliding mechanism for it. So that's it, a very quick walkthrough. It's difficult to talk a lot about mechanical CAD except without actually showing you the live working. So I didn't want too many slides here that would kind of bore you to death. But if you have questions, then I'm happy to take them and see if I can answer them. I might not know everything, but I'll try and do my best. Thank you.
It's been a while since I've looked at the roadmap for version 6, but I do remember there are going to be some changes to the 3D workflow. Are you aware of those changes, or do you know kind of what's coming down the pipeline and how that would change your process?
No, not really. Okay, you mean from the KiCad side, right?
Yeah, from the KiCad.
No, I think we'll have to hear it from Wayne's mouth on that. Yep. Yes, you could. You could.
Just repeat the question. Can you use Step Up to deal with the board edges and other types of workflow in DXF stuff?
You don't even have to do it through Step Up, actually. You can just draw a sketch and save it as a DXF, which can get imported into KiCad natively. So it's pretty straightforward. Like, I mean, FreeCAD supports almost every format there is except DW. I think it even does DWG, which is proprietary. Awesome. Looks like. Oh, here's another.
Do you have to have the WRL and the like STP file to do this?
No, not necessarily. Not anymore. There was a time in the earlier versions when you always had to have a WRL file, but now you could just use step files even within KiCad, and it works. The only disadvantage is, like I said, you will lose some of the color and lighting information which is embedded within a WRL file. So the step translation would lose some of that part.
Okay, and one big thing I find when I'm working with steps and KiCad is that sometimes they just like don't show up. Do you have any idea why that would be the case? Or like common things you do to debug that process? Or do you always use like the step up tool to align your footprint, and you do that in FreeCAD and then export?
Sorry, so usually if I'm already building the part in FreeCAD, it never goes wrong. It usually just aligns with the footprint. If my CAD space zero coordinate is the same as my KiCad zero. But if it's a part that's coming from an external library, there could be translation issues where it's off center or not, you know, properly aligned with the XYZ axis. In which case, when you see it, it's probably out of your field of view, most likely. Quite often by a huge margin, so you might have to actually use the zoom all function to see that it kind of goes out somewhere. That could be one reason.
It never seems to work.
Well, it's worked for me. I've downloaded a few step files from DigiKey and they worked for me. So maybe if you have some specific case, you can show me and we can see if we can sort it out.
Okay, I do.
Yeah.
Awesome. Thank you.
Yeah.
Do you have any good lessons learned or pain points that are still exist or just problems that this software problems that this process solves?
So yes, just
any wisdom you have.
Pain points, yes. FreeCAD is still work in progress. Okay. It's open source. Sometimes it crashes, sometimes it doesn't work, sometimes you lose your work. So if you are happy with that, if you are ensuring that you're taking backups every so often, because FreeCAD can do that, you can set it up to have a backup every couple of minutes or whatever time you want, then it's okay. I've had times when I've lost work because something went wrong, and you know the whole CAD tree is built on a hierarchy. So if you do something down below the line that breaks something that's further up, it's not always easy to recover. especially because I'm not a mech engineer by training, so I'm learning as I go. So a lot of the things I might be doing is probably wrong. So quite often it's probably not right to blame the tool when it's the guy, the problem between the computer and the chair, actually. So.
Have you mentioned CAD query as a scripting language. Have you heard or been able to experiment with OpenSCAD or had anyone say like one's better or the other? Or do you have an opinion?
No, I don't. But there is actually also an OpenSCAD workbench for FreeCAD. So if you're happy to use that, you can do that and you can just type away as you would in OpenSCAD and it does the job. But from what I've seen of CAD query, again, I'm not a software guy or programming guy, but from what I've seen, CAD query is pretty much just about the same as OpenSCAD. And there are a couple of good videos, and maybe I already have them in the links. If not, you can ask me, and I'll let you know.
Are you running the 3D modeling workshop tomorrow?
Yes, I am, in the afternoon. So there's this video that says getting started with CAD query scripting. I will post this, and that should get you started. It's pretty straightforward. Well, I'm running a PDF file. Oh, here you are. Okay. Well, it's numbers and digits, so kind of easier if I just share the the file.
This actually put it into the video, so.
Okay.
If you get all the URLs.
So here's one.
Description, that would help too.
Let me get the other two important ones. That's this one. And this one. These three are pretty interesting. Yeah, better than nothing.
All right, let's give Anool a hand.
Thank you very much.